Alright. Emily, it might just be us today, but we'll make it worthwhile, I assure you. Welcome to the Berman Hour. Today is Tuesday, May 19th. My name is Jeff Berman. I am coming to you live from Los Angeles, California. It's good to be with you. It's good to be alive. It's good to be with people who are doing interesting things. Charlie Stavish, I see you. Today's guest is Emily Silver. Emily Silver Stavish. She is an artist. She makes really cool, very weird art. She's also a yoga instructor, and this is going to be a fun conversation. I can't wait to bring her in, so I'm going to do so right now. There we go. Hey!
the music and the cat nailed it.
You know, I've been watching some of my competitors, you know, my colleagues, really, the Kimmels, and they've got some quirky things on their show. So I thought I would, you know, throw that in as well. But how are you doing?
I'm good. I'm great.
Yeah. Are you in your back studio house now?
I am in the studio.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. I love your glasses. Those are great.
Thank you. Bon look. Thank you. Yeah.
Nice. I wanted to talk to you about a number of things, but first things first, the most important thing. You have two pugs, and their names are?
Walter and Henry.
And the question that everyone wants to know the answer to, everyone needs to know, perhaps nothing more pertinent and more timely, we need to know right now, are they good boys?
Good boys. They're the best boys. They are thriving in quarantine. They are, they think we quit everything to just be with them. So there's a lot of snuggling, a lot of baby things. Henry has a baby that he carries in his mouth everywhere. So there's a lot of that happening on the daily. We have to see baby, see what baby's up to with him. Yeah, there's just a lot. There's a lot with the pugs. They kind of run the quarantine. They dictate where we can sit now, things like that, you know.
Oh, my goodness. Well, I mean, I've been introduced to baby a few times, so I'm glad that baby's still around. But I'm a little surprised that they've let the power go to their heads, and now they really, really feel like they own the property and it's theirs.
Yeah, they have meltdowns. I go to the studio and it's like, I don't know what, 25 feet away from the house, and they have, Walter sounds like a human child is shrieking from the house. So there's a little bit of separation anxiety that's happening. So
yeah, that's pretty good. Well, I want to get into your art and I want to get into your yoga stuff. But first, I want to kind of get into the fact that we know each other. We know each other from living in Los Angeles, but the past few years, you and your husband, Charlie, have moved from Los Angeles out to the Joshua Tree area. What has that, notwithstanding quarantine and pandemic and apocalypse, but what has that been like for you as a transition?
For me, it's been amazing. I've wanted to be here for a while, and it's been a year and a half full time here. We bought our house like 5 years ago, and the transition, I mean, Joshua Tree feels sometimes like it's just a suburb of LA, so I don't feel like I'm really missing anything. Everybody that I want to see loves coming out here anyways, so that works out really great. We did move from New York to LA, so this is probably the most rural that we've ever been. And it was you go through like a little bit of, this is a small town thing, but it's awesome. I think it's, I don't know, with social media, being an artist and being 2.5 hours from LA, it's, I don't really feel like it's taken anything away from me. I think it's given me more than anything because I have space to work in.
Yeah. If you are somebody who flies regularly, or if you're somebody who just kind of even casually reads up on travel blogs or anything like that, you really do not have trouble finding an article that has to do with the influx of city folk that are moving to Joshua Tree and Yucca Valley and Palms. And you guys are kind of part of that crest of momentum and of people. But being a former New Yorker, I think that's a little saltiness to you. So when you see those articles, if you see them, how do they make you feel? And also when you kind of encounter that, we'll call it Silver Lake, Williamsburg chic fashion kind of vibe out in the desert, do you kind of accept it as like that's part of where you live, or does it just fucking infuriate you?
I think, I don't know if I really care anymore. You know, I think when I lived in New York, I lived in Williamsburg in like 2001, nobody would come see me. I lived at the Lorimer stop. It was too far in, too deep in, and now it's unrecognizable, that area. So I think then it was infuriating, but I was part of the problem, right? I was doing the same thing. I think now, people that want to be out here and that want to really live out here, it's because there's a real love for the landscape and for the desert and for community. And I think that's very important if you live here, is that you're participating or you're enthusiastic about the community, you're mindful about your footprint, that's really the only enraging part, is when people come and they're disrespectful to the desert. Like they just want to come and take acid and hang their hammock on a Joshua tree, which is illegal, by the way, everyone, just so you know.
I learned
and
that.
That's kind of annoying.
I learned that from Charlie, because you were kind enough to let my bandmates and I stay at your house at one point when you weren't there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Nick's like Mr. Outdoorsman, and he's like, their hammock game is not really on point. I'm going to fix it. So we like set up this elaborate thing and it was perfect. And as we were leaving, we texted Charlie and said, hey, like Nick fixed your hammock. And he goes, he didn't hang it on a Joshua tree, did he? And we were like, oh shit. And we had to turn around. We were like 30 minutes away. We turned around and anyway, that's neither here nor there. But
yes. Don't hang hammocks on Joshua trees. So everyone knows. They are protected. They are protected. Yep. Yeah. But no, I think it's great. I think people, like, if you want to leave the city and be part of a community and go to smaller towns, like, I think it's important right now. I think people want more space. They want an affordable place to live, and people really need community right now. So I think if whatever floats your boat with that, as long as you're not an asshole, you know, I think that's.
Yeah. So today is May 19th. We're entering summer. How many snakes have you seen so far?
You hate snakes. So I have, I saw a dead snake yesterday on my run. I almost stepped on it. But I haven't seen any live snakes yet this season. I will send you a picture when I do. I did have this morning... We had a really big windstorm last night, and our desert winds, we call them murder winds out here. They're like very, no scorpions, Rob, I saw that question. They're like, it's like an equivalent to a really rainy day when it's super windy. You can't really do anything outside. It's pretty paralyzing. It blew my studio open, and I didn't realize that till this morning. And when I came out, I got attacked by pigeons in my studio.
Holy shit.
That I wasn't fine. Okay, well.
Oh, my goodness. But that. Now, or are you just, you made peace with them and they're going to live there?
They're out now. I got them out after they swooped onto my head a few times, but I got them out finally. But no snakes, knock on wood, yet for me. But I've seen a lot of pictures of friends having some real snake things happen.
Well, I'm glad that you're in the room of your home where you are, because we can see some of your art. And even for the photo, even though you were like so blatantly unpolished in Photoshop form in that photo that I used, I liked it because it showcased some of your art. Mm-hmm. Which I have a serious difficulty trying to kind of generalize or describe. Like it's really cool, it's really beautiful, it's very chaotic. A lot of it is of people, but with like these really exaggerated features. Some of them, private parts. Some of them just noses and eyes that are really exaggerated. But it's very much like a beautiful chaos, and a lot of the sculptures that you do are kind of like if a party exploded and then like had a big bang and came together. It's like all kind of weird pieces of various things. How would you describe your art, or how do you describe your art in terms of useful adjectives, so I don't have to ask you that question the next time?
Well, recently I've been making work. I make these videos and digital collages in only basically using social media. So I use Instagram stories and I use all those GIFs and animations and stack them and pile them until it breaks my Instagram and it closes, and then I have to redo it, like bring it. So I save it while it's going, and then I bring it back in, and then I add more. And those, from there, I make paintings. So I take stills, so you can see some of the ones that I'm working on, but they'll be, stills from them that I then paint. But I'm interested, so those have been this kind of interest in our indulgence, in our machines, in our technology, how we communicate, how we hide behind things, how these spaces are often artificial and offer us like a sense of not importance, but we can put on through social. I've been exploring that as a kind of as a very kind of sensual space too, because I find it embarrassing and funny and all of that. So that's kind of where I've been playing, and also kind of working with what is identity then, like who are we today? When we operate through a lens and through layers and through filters. And so that's why you often see like body parts and people in and out of these spaces, because they're always hidden or covered or overlapped with these things. But then recently I've been, you can see, I haven't really talked about these a lot, but there's these newer paintings since we've had this pandemic has kind of really pushed a lot of that superficial stuff out and more into the curiosity about this kind of collective suffering, this collective mourning that we're going through, and the absurdity of it all. And how, again, and still social media and through technology is a way that we're able to still see each other, to communicate. I'm a professor, I'm an adjunct professor at two colleges. So I've been teaching only through the screen now. And so my authority has changed with them and with my role and with their role. And it's so interesting. It's just really fascinating. So I've been kind of exploring that, so you can see those things in there.
Do you feel like with at least with the ones that you just showed, and maybe in general, something that you said that caught my attention was that you kind of see this as a collective suffering. I think a lot of people tend to see it, a lot of people personalize it or internalize it. And I think a lot of people also, I know I do, I kind of go through fits of both of that in any damn day, you know. Do you think that the art that you're creating reflects that more of kind of the personal struggles that you're going through, or does it reflect more of the collective struggle that you had mentioned?
I think there's both. I think a lot of it has to do with me because I'm the maker of it, obviously. But a lot of it also has to do with, like, I have 80 students and I hear from them what they're going through. I find myself like laughing until I'm crying, and then I realize that I'm just actually crying, right? Like it, and laughter was just the vehicle that got me there. And And then I'm back to having the best day ever or the worst day ever. And it's, I think there, we're mourning. We're all mourning. Whether we want to admit it or not, we're collectively mourning a shift in life. And things aren't the way that they were. And we're unsure if they're going to go back to the way that they were. And it's just as simple as, like, you can't hug somebody, you know, and we're just mourning together. And I think people are dealing with it differently. People have their own belief systems on what's going on. People have their own way of coping with it. Some people have been on the front lines the whole time. Yeah. And it's just a really interesting time. And so I think it's a collective thing, but it's also a daily thing, like getting ready for no reason or cutting your own hair or, being stuck with the same people all the time, right? You know, like it's really interesting to just have to, I love my husband so much and I have a really awesome husband, you know him, and we've never had to spend this much time together, and you're probably going through that with your wife as well, and I feel really fortunate for it. There are days that I know he wants to wring my neck, and it's like a mutual thing. Like, people have to take time outs from things. But so there's some real beauty of like getting to know somebody again that you already know really well, but on a deeper level. So there's that too.
Yeah, it's been really beautiful. I'm very grateful that I have my wife, and in general, obviously, but specifically through all this. So I've seen you guys through a couple of apartments in your house now, which is no secret because we're friends. And your art has always kind of been brightly and prominently displayed in your own home, which is great. And I've always known you to be one hell of a creative person. I was struck by something you said, what feels like 2 days ago, but it might have actually been 2 months ago at this point. I think it was the first yoga video that you put out, your yoga instructor instructing video. And you said something to the effect of how you were wanting to make a video like this so that people could take lessons from you and that you could kind of feel like you were connecting and doing something positive, but that you needed to kind of ground yourself first and that you had a little bit of difficulty doing that. The reason we're talking right now in this platform is because I was partially inspired by what you said, because as I was listening to you in that yoga instruction, I too felt as if through social media, I was watching all of these people just have this constant flow of creativity where I was just completely stifled. I couldn't write about anything. I couldn't envision anything. I couldn't plan anything. And, you know, that kind of negative thought process, when it turned positive, turned into just doing a silly talk show every day where I could connect with creative types. But if I may, I'd like to first of all thank you for kind of saying that, because I think I needed to hear it from another creative type that wasn't somebody that I'm living with, although I said it too. But I was really curious, how stifled were you, and was there something or someone or some just parcel of inspiration that broke you out of that funk, if you don't mind sharing?
Well, I think it's very important that, speaking of social media and where my work had been rooted in, is that we're in such a collective time right now that I felt it was important to be vulnerable with everybody and let people know, like, hey, I'm struggling. And I do teach yoga, and I teach it 5 days a week in a small community in Joshua Tree. And I have people that I just love that I connect with regularly that are regular students of mine. And as much as that yoga practice is important to them, it's really important to me as well. And I didn't feel immediately, a lot of people I know were able to immediately get onto the digital platforms and start teaching yoga or making art right away, and they felt like they could do it. I personally felt like, holy shit, what's going on? You know, like, what's going on? I'm not grounded. I need to take a few deep breaths. I need to talk to my therapist. I need to like ask for help. And through that, I went through the normal, like, first few weeks, like, panicky and like trying to get everything in line and make things feel normal. And I, you know, teaching college, I only had 4 days to adjust my curriculum for one of the schools. And I felt really, really overwhelmed. And I thought that if I jumped right into teaching yoga, for me personally, it would be coming from a space that I felt was forced and not genuine. And therefore, I wasn't holding space for people. And I wouldn't be able to receive or give. And that whole practice to me is about all of those things. So I didn't want to do it because it felt like it was a job. But I think that the moment was just me saying to myself, hey, it's okay that this sucks, and it's okay that you don't want to do this right now, and it's okay that maybe you're letting some people down that need you right now, but right now you need to put 2 feet on the ground and a hand on your chest and take a deep breath. And that's kind of when I felt like I could teach yoga again during this whole thing. And that's when I made that video, and Charlie helped me make it, and it was really great. And the same with getting back into my studio. I felt like all the work that I had been making before was irrelevant. And because it was dark in a way, but super playful in a way. And now I needed to make work that spoke to what the human condition was right now for me. And so that's where these new paintings are coming out of as well.
Yeah, that's a really beautiful way of putting it. And I appreciate you sharing that, because it's okay to not be okay in a time that's not okay. And it's also okay in normal times to just fucking suck with technology and, you know, having that burden of that was whatever. Something I did notice, I knew Charlie helped you with that video, because when like, a wide shot, I was like, those are the best microphones I've ever.
Yeah.
Definitely. Speaking of yoga, I don't want to get too much into kind of like what you do with it, but I'm curious how you made the transition, or what inspired you to make the transition from just being a yogi that liked to do it and go to classes a lot, to actually becoming an instructor.
Yeah, there was a lot that went into that. I had some, it's hard to be an artist. It's hard to be a creative person, be a musician, all of those things. You're not only basically a small business owner on it, you're also creative and it's personal. And so therefore you're emotional about it. And it's harder you have to get out of your own way all the time and then be able to see the thing that you do as a bigger picture, right? As a product or
the branding process too, which you never really think about when you start it.
Yeah, exactly. So there's that, and that had been exhausting, and yoga was a safe space for me. I also am not a very stereotypical like yogi, in the sense that like I talk like a sailor sometimes. I have been in and out of being plus size and having weight issues, and I just felt like I could speak to and wanted to be an accessible human in that space, where I could create a space that felt safe for other people to practice that maybe were afraid to get on their mat because they didn't think they could touch their toes, or they were skinny, or they were beautiful, or whatever it was that they were hung up on, because that practice is what changed me. So I wanted to be able to do that for other people.
Yeah. And, you know, without, at the risk of sounding like we're talking shit, which we're not, but like, we both know that type of yoga instructor where it's enough of a turnoff, you know, whether it be kind of so kind of bohemian and out there and not really grounded. And then on the other hand, where it's so focused on kind of the physicality of it, where you just, you know, it's like having the worst gym partner that you could imagine, you know?
Yeah.
What inspired you, I keep using that word, you have your own gallery. So you went from being an artist to also a curator. You guys mm-hmm. have a massive shipping container on your property, and you went through and made it nice, and it's called Unpaved Gallery. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so about 5 years ago, I started a podcast and blog called Curate Joshua Tree, and I would interview artists in their studios and photograph them working. And then from there, I started curating a few shows over at my friend's place, Outpost Projects, Eileen. She owns a place in Flamingo Heights. And the first show that I curated was just of artists that I had interviewed, and like 200 people came to the opening. Yeah. And I was floored. I thought like 5 people listened to my podcast. It just seemed like crazy. And then we did it again, and Desert Oracle got involved, and they did a live radio show from it. And it was just this moment of like, the whole reason was to cultivate community, to archive all the work that's happening out here, because there's so many artists out here and musicians and just creative people who are sick of running out other people's games, and they want their own, and they're out here making shit happen. And so the project was just to really document all these awesome humans. And from that, Stephanie, who's, we went to undergrad together, she is like my best friend, lives down the road. And she and I were just talking about it, and she and I were like, you should just do this on your own. The Curate Joshua Tree should just like keep curating. I didn't want to do it on my own. She was interested in curating it. Okay. It was like, let's do a gallery. And she's like, your container, I mean, you just use it for storage. And so that was kind of the birth of Unpaved, was her and I in a hot tub, wearing weights on our ankles and wrists so that we wouldn't float to the top of the tub. It's the best way to hot tub at night when you're stargazing, because you can get weighted in one spot. Yeah, it's perfect. Yeah, workout weights. So that's how Unpaved was born. And Unpaved is a year, almost a year and a half. And it's a container that's completely drywalled with a beautiful light in it. And we kicked it off January 2019, and that was a huge success. And then we're on 5 acres, and we have Desert Tacos come, our favorite taco truck in the area. And it's a big happening. We have just like a big art opening that's more, it's not stuffy, it's like about community. Sometimes there's a fire and people are just hanging and looking at art and meeting each other and stuff. So
that's awesome.
Yeah,
it's exactly what you had envisioned and kind of wanted to make for yourself out there. You've created it.
Yeah, it's great. And it's not, none of it's to, doesn't fund anything. It's all like a way to give back. It's a way to participate in community, to build community, and to be a springboard to support artists, because it's fucking hard to be an artist, and it's hard to get opportunities, and it's a rat race. And every time we have an economic downfall, it just keeps the same 5 to 10 people at the fucking top. And so these smaller spaces that can help support artists are important, and that's why we did it, you know.
Yeah, well, you deserve a lot of credit. I know you're humble and selfless to accept it, but you certainly deserve a lot of credit, because you've not only moved out there to do what you're doing and create in the manner in which you're doing the art that you're doing, you've become a conduit for so many people and so many other artists. So that's
thank you. And then we have this recording studio, you know, on site. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I've spent many there. I wish I could be there this week. We've got shit to finish, but
I know.
I guess the world has other plans. But it was great to see you, albeit through the internet, and it was great to talk with you. Thank you so much for coming on the Berman Hour and sharing your information about your art and your gallery and your yoga and personal information and everything. This is great. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, Kate's screaming in the background. She loves you as well.
Hi, Kate. Good luck on your move, you guys.
Thank you very much. We're gonna miss you guys a lot, for sure.
Yeah, we'll miss you too.
All right. I'm gonna try to convince Charlie to do one of these shows sometime next month too. So
yeah, he's super awkward about talking, but you could try and get him on there.
Maybe I'll have Henry and Walter on the show, and he can just kind of be, you know, the one that guides them in the interview, because they might need some guidance.
Do you see his empathy?
With that, I bid you adieu. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you for being on, Emily. And we'll talk to everybody soon, and we'll see everyone next time.
Bye, you guys.
Bye-bye.